policy which is contained in the outline presented in the book is one of three elements of policy about which the future existence of civilization depends, including the continuation of civilization even as far distant as the end of this century. It is a policy which, in part, the land bridge element, has been adopted by China, which is now receiving cooperation from Iran, significant cooperation from Iran, for reasons which Helga will indicate, has recently received endorsement and offers of cooperation from the President of India in meetings, public meetings with Jiang Zemin of China. It has the expressed interest of Turkey by the present Prime Minister Erbakan in terms of cooperation with Iran. Recently, we've had the government of Armenia has emphasized its importance of its collaboration with Iran because of this kind of policy. It has the support in significant degree of the foreign ministry of Russia, Evgeny Primakov. And in the most recent period, since the French government has broken with the British government in a dramatic move over the issue of British Commonwealth genocide in Africa, that the French government has entered into new degrees of cooperation with Germany, both against British Commonwealth genocide in Africa and also in support of Germany's, France's, Russia's, and other countries' interest in cooperation with Iran, with India, with Asia and Russia in developing this type of orientation of economic cooperation across Eurasia, across continental Eurasia, and into Africa. Now, the background of this is how we got into this business. It started formally in 1982-83, when I was invited by representatives of the U.S. executive branch to set up a back-channel discussion with the Soviet government. And it was agreed that the subject of my discussion would include, among other things, a presentation of my design for a strategic ballistic missile defense to be mutually supported, hopefully, by both governments, the development of which would be utilized to provide new technologies for recovery of the world in general from the economic disaster which was already then in progress. During 1982, from February of 1983, I conducted negotiations through this back channel with the Soviet government. In February, the Soviet government turned down the policy recommendation I made, though they were still interested in economic discussions. But in March of the same year, 23rd, the President of the United States, Reagan, adopted and presented the policy which I'd been discussing with the Soviets and became known as the Strategic Defense Initiative. Now, in the process of those discussions, in February, my last meeting with the Soviet representative, I met the same gentleman recently in Russia. We had some reminiscence on these things. But in my last meeting, I warned him that if the President of the United States were to offer the kind of cooperation which I had outlined to him and his government, and that if the Soviet government refused that offer of Reagan's, then within about 5 years, the Soviet economy would collapse. Right? Now, 1988 came, 5 years later. In Berlin, on October 12th of 1988, as a part of my Democratic nomination presidential campaign at the time, I gave a Columbus Day press conference in Berlin, in which I announced the imminent disintegration of the Comecon and Warsaw Pact in their present form, and indicated both that Poland would probably be the first nation to break out of the Comecon-Warsaw Pact alliance, and secondly, that Berlin would likely become soon the designated new capital of a unified Germany. I indicated that we must take, from the standpoint of the United States, that for the coming period of the coming administration, the primary policy question on the table of the United States would be the breakup of the Warsaw Pact Comecon alliance, and that the United States would have to base its global policy on that fact as the central feature of the strategic landscape for the coming period. Within a few months, I also broadcast this on the national television broadcast here in the United States, a televised copy of that address which I gave in Berlin at the Berlin Press Conference. Within about a year from there, as we all know, the Berlin Wall began to crumble. It had started, as I had indicated earlier, in Poland, which was the first nation to break the Comecon bonds. Then in October through December of 1989, the Berlin Wall crumbled. And there were two policies on the table of the world. One was the policy which I'd indicated, that we must reach out to the former Soviet Union and the states of Eastern Europe to create a new form of economic cooperation, based in part on the fact that in the Soviet military-industrial sector, there was one of the most important concentrations of strategic machine tool capability in the world. And the collaboration between the United States and France and Germany, especially Germany, with that sector would be the potential science technology driver for a generalized world recovery. That was my policy. It was also the policy of a leading German banker, Alfred Herrhausen of Deutsche Bank, who unfortunately was assassinated in British interest in November of that year on the basis of a similar policy which he had enunciated for Eastern Europe. The other policy was the policy of Margaret Thatcher and the person she describes as her little poodle dog, President George Bush, who she could make do anything she wanted to make him do. I asked Helga about that, how that works. Sometimes the dogs make you do what you want them to, they want you to do, but they other way. So Bush and Thatcher took the wrong policy. We're now in a global disaster. The likelihood of civilization surviving in its present form to the end of the century is almost zero. We are presently in the worst financial crisis in the history of modern Europe. Within a matter of weeks or months, some say weeks, some say months, it doesn't make any difference. The Titanic is sinking anyway, and the day in which it sinks is not the issue. The question is, do we have the sense to get off the ship before it sinks? Not can we, like the hogs on Wall Street, wait till the last moment to get out of the market just before it collapses. That's people get slaughtered doing that. So the two issues are this. First of all, to deal with this crisis and the banking system collapse is inevitable. It is not because Japan's bad policy or somebody else's bad policy, it's because of everybody's bad policy. The IMF's bad policy, London's bad policy, our bad policy. We've been destroying modern economy. We've lowered the productive powers of labor. Most parts of the third world, especially Africa and to some degree Central and South America, are suffering far more than they ever did 30 years ago. The condition of mankind in general on this planet is far worse than it was 30 years ago in physical parameters. Yes, there is a facade, one might say a Potemkin village facade of prosperity still around the planet. It's like one of these houses you get in Northern Virginia. It's all facade, but the inside is not worth having. And you can charge you $250,000 or more for the experience of having the house collapse around you. And that's our economy. As a result of this kind of economy, we have built up the greatest financial bubble in history, a bubble which amounts to trading of about $3 trillion a day, where the support is collapsing from underneath it. This bubble will collapse. Nothing can prevent this bubble from collapsing except putting it into bankruptcy. Therefore, there are three elements which are required to get out of this mess. First of all, a number of governments led by the United States executive, that means President Clinton in this period, whatever you think of Clinton, he's got the ball, must initiate an emergency new Bretton Woods conference to reestablish immediately the best features of the Bretton Woods system prior to 1966. That is, a system of stable parities, a system which whose trade and tariff agreements are essentially protectionist in nature, yeah? A system to foster cheap credit for long-term investment in international markets, and to foster scientific and technological progress. A new Bretton Woods, which must essentially meet over a weekend, declare the present international monetary and financial institutions to be bankrupt, to agree to put these institutions into government-supervised receivership for reorganization, to prevent social chaos, and to preserve essential structure of fiscal and financial administration, and to foster cancel all existing trade and tariff agreements, to set up a new set of mutually advantageous protectionist arrangements in order to foster investment and growth within national sectors. Once that's done, the second thing is to find a major series of projects which can lead to an economic recovery in the sense that Roosevelt, during the late 1930s, conceived an economic recovery of the United States. You must have large-scale infrastructure projects, otherwise no economic recovery. And this world is a mess. Most of the world does not function precisely because there's not the infrastructure present in terms of transportation, power, and so forth to enable the world to function. You can't have peace in the Middle East because there's not enough water in the area of Palestine in adjoining Jordan to sustain the existing population. Without large-scale water development projects, which includes desalination on a mass scale, there's no possibility of peace in the Middle East, as typical of the infrastructure projects. The problems in Africa are largely the key economic problem is infrastructure. Clean water to drink, efficient transportation, adequate power resources. Without these elements, there is no hope of economic development in Africa. In Asia, we have the greatest concentration of the world's population, with a totally inadequate inland infrastructure development. The greatest part of the human population, ready for growth, but unable to do so effectively for reason of lack of adequate development of infrastructure. So therefore, the Eurasian land bridge conception, an idea which was initially presented in the 1860s by Henry C. Carey, the economist who was also a partner of President Abraham Lincoln. And Carey proposed that the lessons of Europe and the United States in opening up the western lands from the Atlantic to the Pacific and then similarly in Europe through railroad development corridors be utilized throughout Eurasia from the Atlantic to the Pacific and to the Indian Ocean to accomplish similar results in Eurasia. This policy presented by Carey, which was later adopted by important circles in Germany, was spread into Russia, into China and others, and resulted in a policy which caused Britain to organize World War I. That is the so-called land bridge program of certain French interests associated with Sadi Carnot, the president of France who was assassinated, with Gabriel Anatol, the foreign minister and historian, with Count Sergei Witte of Russia, with circles around the Chinese movement of Sun Yat-sen in China, with interests pre-1894 interests in Japan of the Meiji Restoration, were all agreed on the development of railroad development corridors, not just railroad tracks, railroad development corridors, such as we had used in the United States in developing the western lands of the United States through railway corridors. That must be done throughout Asia. And people associated with the Bates tradition in the United States, with Emil Rathenau and Siemens and others in Germany, the forces I indicated in France, these circles of Dmitry Mendeleev and of Witte in Russia, were united in developing a series of railroad corridors which would extend from the Atlantic, from coast of France to the Pacific, across to the islands and down railroad connections down into Japan itself. The same thing to be done toward the Indian Ocean. The British said plainly at that time that this proposal was a threat to the British Empire. The development of a continental communications network of this type would mean that continental power, of the Eurasian landmass would dominate over the maritime power of the British Empire, and that the British Empire would not tolerate. And thus the British succeeded by a number of measures in organizing World War I to prevent that from occurring. Now it's back on the agenda. Again, the British are prepared to destabilize China, prepared to destabilize Iran, destroy it, and so forth and so on, to prevent this project from occurring. The third element, the land bridge edition of the land bridge program, which is our great recovery program for this planet for the 21st century, is the return to the machine tool principle. The problem we have in Asia, now Japan has a very good machine tool sector, though it's not being helped by the current financial situation or trade situation. Korea has a decent machine tool sector. Taiwan has relatively a very good machine tool sector. The Philippines used to have a bit of a machine tool sector until they shut it down and packed it up and shipped it out back to the United States. Indonesia has a very limited machine tool sector, chiefly under the top-down organization of Professor Habibie. Other states in Southeast Asia either have no machine tool sector or virtually none. In India, there's a machine tool sector which is very inadequate relative to the population. China has a machine tool sector which is being fostered, but it's inadequate relative to the population. We have destroyed the strategic machine tool sector in the United States has been virtually destroyed. We have depended upon Germany and Japan for the key elements of our machine tool sector. Without a strategic machine tool sector, you cannot maintain the rate of progress in the productive powers of labor which are needed to sustain a global recovery program. Without the fostering of the machine tool sector, the strategic machine tool sector, the type we used to associate with military technology, without that, you cannot muster the intellectual force needed to increase the productive powers of labor sufficiently to meet the moral requirement which we have to humanity in the coming period. And though those three things are the foundations of a recovery policy, a survival policy for civilization, for the remainder of this century and the next century, and the land bridge program is at the center of it. Helga, who worked with me closely with others in 89 and 90 in developing this program around the so-called productive triangle program in Europe, has been through various phases of this. She's been involved in discussions with China at a high level, discussions with other countries or coordinating that. Michel Liebisch and Arno have been similarly involved with that directly and indirectly. So Helga will present the vital elements of the land bridge program as such, and then in the question period you can ask us, including we have Mr. Michel Liebig and Mr. Arno Hellenbroich also available to answer your questions. Thank you. Helga.
First slide, please. First. This European-Eurasian land bridge is, no matter what the media says or not, the most important strategic question of today. And the success of the economic integration of the Eurasian continent on a very high-level technological basis will determine the fate of mankind. And this is not a question in the very far future ahead, but I think that considering the different strategic parameters, the question if the second Clinton administration takes a positive attitude to make it a foreign policy strategic interest of the United States to support the success of this Eurasian land bridge, or if they remain indifferent, passive, or worse, will indeed determine if mankind plunges into an incredible catastrophe of which the developments in Africa give us a small foretaste, or if we are in front of the biggest economic miracle in world history. This alternative is directly in front of us. And I think next, if you the reason why this question is the most important is fairly obvious. If you look at the population density in the world today, you can see very clearly that the largest concentration of the world population is in China and Southeast Asia and South Asia, very thinly sprinkled in concentrations elsewhere. And this part of the world, South Asia, West Asia, Southeast Asia, is also going to be the area of the largest population growth in the next century. China presently represents 1.2 billion people. It is presently the most populous nation on the world, and it has, without any question, had the most intensive positive economic development of any country on this planet in the last 12 to 17 years, average 10, even 12% annual growth. Now, the fascinating thing right now is that at the Davos World Economic Forum, despite rather hysterical misreporting by the international press, the European Eurasian Land Bridge and the economic development of China, but in a new way also of India, is the most debated topic in Davos in the last couple of days. It is very funny that, you know, while for a long time Mr. LaRouche was like a sole caller in the desert warning about the imminent collapse of the financial system, advocating the Eurasian land bridge, and the international media basically denying both realities, as a matter of fact, not reporting about the true condition of the world financial system, but equally absolutely not reporting about the emerging alternative reality in the form of the Eurasian land bridge. Now, all of a sudden, at the Davos summit, both realities are popping out and are on the table. Because the two issues which were debated there by some of the world leading financial, economic, and political leaders was, on the one side, the imminent financial crash of the speculative bubble, possibly triggered by the crisis in Japan or other factors, the systemic crisis of the system as a whole, but also the Eurasian land bridge. And some people were completely annoyed about the self-assuredness with which the Chinese representative and the Prime Minister of India presented the development perspectives of their respective countries in Davos. But let me first give you a taste of what is the debate, especially in Europe, about the imminence of the financial crash, because I don't think that those of you who looked at the State of the Union address of President Clinton last night got the full flavor of what the debate right now is. The director of the Institute for International Economics in Washington, C. Fred Bergston, did make a speech at the Davos conference warning of the new dangers to the financial system coming from Japan, triggered by the yen crisis plus the overall economic situation in Japan, which would pose new threats to the international system. He says there's the danger of a vicious circle, a weakness of the financial system in Japan, combined with a Japanese restrictive monetarist policy, which could lead to a continuous fall of the yen. Panic selling could hit Japan in the stock market. Then banks would have no choice than to liquidate their foreign assets. This would then have devastating consequences on foreign markets. And then in addition, you could have new Mexico-style crises in the emerging markets at any moment, most likely Brazil and Argentina, and that could then trigger a chain reaction all over the world. Next. But this was not the only voice. In the meantime, you have European conservative financial dailies like the Neue Zürcher Zeitung, which is like the paper of Swiss banking and conservative circles on the 24th of January, reporting in a big banner headline, are the stock markets in front of a new crash, comparison to the developments of 1929 and 1887. So Professor Gerhard Aschinger from the University of Fribourg basically describes that his scenario of the coming crash is divided into six phases leading up to a market crash. And he says we are presently in the fifth phase, passing into the sixth. The fifth phase is characterized by euphoria and irrational behavior by those people speculating in the market in terms of a mass psychology. Then in the sixth phase, a panic erupts and the bubble bursts. He says that the transition from the fifth to the sixth phase can be triggered by events and news which are not so important in themselves, but because they lead to an upset in the expectation to make just a little bit more profit in the speculation, the mass psychology that will then turn into a panic. He says that the fact that the Dow Jones has risen by 70% since the beginning of 95 till the end of 96 can only be compared to the speculative bubble of the 27-29 period. And he also completely agrees on that point with Mr. LaRouche that the longer the bubble continues to grow, the larger the crash implosion will be. But these are not individual voices. I will give you some more to show you that right now there is an entire chorus of people warning about the impending crash, what up to recently only Mr. LaRouche and our organization has said. On January 15th, in Frankfurt, the president of the German Savings and Loans Association, Horst Köhler, warned that overnight waves of chaotic currency speculations could erupt. On 19th of January, at a seminar of the Protestant Academy of Tutzing, the former chief economist of the Bavarian Hypo Bank, Volker Hölterhoff, says the world financial markets are incredibly endangered. The arch monetarist of Deutsche Bank, Norbert Walter, says the world financial markets are decoupled completely from the real economy. Especially dangerous the derivatives, and the press-taking volume of these derivatives is absolutely frightening. 20th of January, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung predicts that the stock market hype in New York and Europe is just the buying spree based on the assumption that the party will be over soon. Le Monde, 21st of January, is the financial world going up in flames? They have a three-page supplement of the danger of a financial blowout that basically saying that alone during the first 9 months of the last year of 96, 1,195 billion of stocks and bonds have been issued. That is 1.1 trillion dollar stocks and bonds have been issued. In which context they quote the US stockbroker Charles Schwab saying, how can anyone not tremble when imagining the consequences of an eventual brutal displacement of such masses of capital? Now, this gives you the setting of why there is no way how this world will survive unless we do very soon the kind of reorganization Mr. LaRouche has proposed, why we need a new Bretton Woods system, and why after the reorganization of the world financial system, the Eurasian land bridge must be the cornerstone of a global reconstruction of the world economy. But let me give you very briefly the history of the emergence of this concept. In 1975, Mr. LaRouche gave in Milan and in Bonn a press conference in which he basically predicted that the present or then existing international monetary system of the IMF would inevitably go bankrupt and should be replaced by a different credit creation institution, namely the International Development Bank, to facilitate long-term cheap interest credit for capital investment and capital goods transfer from the industrialized sector to the so-called developing sectors to overcome the underdevelopment of Africa, Latin America, and large parts of Asia. In 1978, this proposal, by the way, was then taken up by the non-alignment movement in 1976 in their Colombo resolution demanding a just new world economic order. Then, because obviously powerful forces prevented this from being implemented, Mr. LaRouche proposed in 1978 that the then existing European monetary system should be the cornerstone of such a reorganization of the world economy. In 1982, he proposed the urgent debt reorganization of the third world, a cancellation of most of the debt, and basically then to reorganize the world banking system in the famous Operation Juarez proposal, centering on the economic integration of the Latin American continent, which was begun to be implemented by López Portillo, president of Mexico, at that point. Then came in 1984, next, Mr. LaRouche wrote with his associates a study for the 50-year, for the 50-year development of the Pacific Basin, which basically proposed large infrastructure programs for India, for the Mekong Delta, for South China, for large parts, the Kra Canal, for large parts of South China and other places. And if you compare the present policies of the Chinese government and you know reflect on the shift which China has made away from the policies of the Cultural Revolution, at least you find very interesting parallels between these two approaches. In 1988, Mr. LaRouche made the famous proposal for soon to become a real unification of Germany, which he just referenced. He was, in my knowledge, the only Western economist and statesman predicting the collapse of the Soviet Union more than a year before it happened. He was the only one who predicted the unification of Germany at a point where all German politicians called the unification of Germany the lie of the century, people should forget about it, and so forth. And Mr. LaRouche said, let's take a unified Germany and use Western technologies to develop Poland and make that the model how you can transform the economies of the Warsaw Pact with Western means into a modern modern economy. Then in 1989, at a point when you all remember the pictures in the TV, the Berlin Wall came down beginning of November. People were happy. There was an incredible historical moment. And you know, again, I must say, given the fact that I and my friends, Michael and Anno, were on the scene busily trying to shape history, there was not anyone, not Kohl, for sure not from the Clinton from the US administration or anywhere else who had an idea what to do, how to capture the historical moment of, you know, the fact that the wall dividing the Eurasian continent would come down, you know, really the first time since the Versailles Treaty. except Mr. LaRouche, who proposed, go back to the previous one, who proposed the famous program of the productive triangle, which was the idea to take the territory in the triangular between Paris, Berlin, and Vienna, which is about the size of Japan, and which still to the present day concentrates the highest concentration of industrial capacity and skilled labor power, and goes through Saxonia, Bohemia, parts of Czechoslovakia, combining for the first time the industrial centers of France, the Ruhrgebiet, Saxonia, Bohemia, into one coherent piece. He proposed that this should basically be upgraded through the most modern infrastructure network, including the Maglev train, the Transrapid, other investments in avant-garde technologies, to make this then the most powerful locomotive to for the world economy to recover. Basically, this proposal we put on the table in November 1989 to the Kohl government, to all the European governments, East and West. We basically proposed that, you know, basically Eastern Europe should be integrated through the development corridors, namely the idea to build up transport lines, one corridor going from Warsaw to Moscow, St. Petersburg, another one to Kiev, another one to the Balkans, to the Black Sea, another one to Sicily, bridging into Africa, another one to the Ibero-American Peninsula through practically a bridge and reaching into Africa. Now, this report was published in all European languages in 1990. We presented it in many conferences and seminars in Warsaw, Minsk, Moscow, in Kiev, in Poland, in Prague, Bratislava, Vienna, Zagreb, Sarajevo, many other places. And basically, what would have been necessary is an approach where the the economies of the Warsaw Pact, which admittedly were not up to the level of the world standard, rather than being dismantled, what happened under the IMF, would have been taken to build up the infrastructure of Eastern Europe to provide the absolute necessary precondition for industrial development and agricultural development. Because one of the inherent flaws of the communist economy was a complete negligence of infrastructure. The Soviet Union, for example, used to lose 40% of their agricultural harvest just because of a lack of infrastructure. If you remember the famous Autobahn in East Germany when the wall opened, which was like a bumping road, the horrible condition of the trains, I mean, you remember that the lack of infrastructure was one of the key problems. Now, basically the idea was then to generate wealth by using up these obsolete technologies of Eastern Europe to then reach the condition where with Western help one could have a kind of Marshall Plan for the East using these corridors, about which I will say more how they function, to drive the economic development of Western Europe into Eastern Europe to raise the level of the former republics, the republics of the former Soviet Union, and fulfill their aspiration that they should join the first world, which is what the people in Ukraine, in Poland, in Lithuania, in Russia, they wanted. They wanted to be part of the advanced West. You all remember this. Well, we know history took a different turn. Mr. LaRouche has mentioned it. The key banker in Germany who was thinking a little bit in the direction like we do, Herrhausen of Deutsche Bank, was assassinated. In the meantime, Deutschlandfunk, the official German radio, has pointed to certain Anglo-American financial interests as being behind the murder, not the Baader-Meinhof group. In the meantime, it is debated that they don't even exist. There is no third generation Baader-Meinhof group. But for geopolitical reasons, Mr. Herrhausen was assassinated, and I'm afraid everybody of rank in Germany knows the details and reasons for this. And Germany, rather than going in the direction we proposed and using the historic chance of Europe, of which everybody correctly spoke, capitulated to the British campaign of Margaret Thatcher, George Bush, and Mitterrand, but especially the British, namely that if Germany would do that, they would become the Fourth Reich. So Kohl, rather than using the historical chance, capitulated, and you know, we look at today a complete collapse of Western Europe and the end of the era Kohl in the next very immediate period. Now, we, however, continued to organize for the realization of this program. Next. In 1992, we presented a proposal for the Eurasian Infrastructure Alliance, because at that point the Soviet Union had collapsed, and we proposed to combine the productive triangular situated in Western Europe through infrastructure lines all the way to China, line A being the northern route, the Vladivostok Trans-Siberian Railroad, line B going through Ukraine, Kazakhstan, China, and line C from Turkey, Iran, Kazakhstan, China. So we proposed to integrate the Eurasian continent into one piece. And basically, again, had many conferences about this in Moscow, in other places. And especially because China at that point was still involved in a very dangerous mixture. On the one side, a state-planned economy, but at the other side, also being absorbed in a speculative bubble. And fortunately, we put out many warnings against AIDS being the financial speculation in the economy, which was published widely in China. So by 93, the Chinese government consciously went away from the bubble economy, put more emphasis on a dirigist policy, and there was a clear next revival of the famous policy of the founder of modern China, Dr. Sun Yat-sen, who in the 1920s had put out a beautiful document called the International Development of China. This is a map he used, which has a very elaborated system of integrated railways, water projects, and other infrastructure programs. Dr. Sun at that point proposed a rail system to be 100,000 kilometers long, 1 million kilometer new roads, large canal projects, and projects for the control of the Yangtze River and the Yellow River, the construction of many new cities, which is all in this map. So, all right, then in 1993, Mr. Delors from the European Union put out the famous Delors White Book, which was practically the original productive triangle transport lines minus the piece going the railway from Munich to Zagreb, because they assumed that the Balkans war would continue for a long time. This white book of Delors was skipped completely and is now in the hidden somewhere in Brussels or I don't know where. Now in 93, 94, there were further important changes in the economic policy of the Chinese government to reduce the bubble, both in the real estate market and in other markets. They implemented more dirigistic measures, put more stress on the Eurasian land bridge, and basically announced that they had the intention to develop the northeast regions of China to improve the relations between China and Europe and the rest of Asia. In May 94, the Vice Minister of the State Commission on Science and Technology, Mr. Hui Chongchen, gave an exclusive interview to Executive Intelligence Review in which he said that the Eurasian land bridge would be the central feature of its international economic and foreign policy. In 94, in August, representatives of the EIR participated in Landshut in a conference on the cooperation for the development of the Eurasian land bridge. And in May 96, I myself, together with a delegation of the Schiller Institute, participated as a speaker at the Beijing conference with the title Development of the Economic Regions Along the Eurasian Land Bridge. This conference was an absolute watershed because the Chinese government announced their strategic long-term perspective for China until the year 2010, which is already written in government legislation. And they have no lesser goal than to bring the entirety of China up to the level of the world as quickly as possible. Different spokesmen, whose speeches you all can read in the report we publish, basically announced that a new era of mankind has started, namely the land bridge era, where for the first time in human history, there will be no more regions of the world which will be disadvantaged because of their geographical positions, but because of the land bridge conception, you can bring the development into all areas around the globe. And especially the landlocked areas will participate in the same kind of advantages like previously only maritime cultures or cultures, civilizations based on rivers. But I think the most important was that this conference, in which I think 64 nations participated, expressed an incredible cultural optimism, an optimism which you do not find in the United States, in Europe, for sure not in Russia. And people were just completely fulfilled with the idea that the underdevelopment of mankind is coming to an end. Now, since that May conference, again, the international press has absolutely not reported this, except one or two tiny articles. There was an absolutely deafening silence about the fact that the majority of the world had come together to decide to overcome underdevelopment. In the meantime, an incredibly breathtaking development has taken place, namely a very wide array of agreements and deals, again, mainly blocked out by the press. Beginning of January of this year, 8 developing countries met in Istanbul, Turkey, forming the so-called D8, Development Aid, as a counterweight to the G7. This was under the leadership of Minister President Erbakan and the participation of the foreign ministries of Iran, Indonesia, Malaysia, Nigeria, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Egypt, representing again about 700 million people, announcing that they would be open for additional members. The aim of the D8, which they announced, was to help its members in their development goals, to function as a partner in the cooperation with other organizations, and basically to be an equal partner to the G7. This all goes back to a vision of Erbakan and Habibi when both of them studied as young students in Aachen University in Germany, where they basically planned that. And I think this should give you optimism. Sometimes you have a good plan and it takes 30, 40 years until you are in a position to realize it. Mr. Erbakan then, the moment he was minister president, went to his first foreign trip to Iran, Pakistan, and Malaysia. And in Tehran, he signed an agreement, large pipeline agreements between Iran and Turkey, which for 23 years is supposed to deliver natural gas from Turkmenistan and Iran to Turkey and beyond. They also agreed on concluding the missing railway link between Tabriz and Van, and they have planned the founding of this organization for June of this year. Next. Now, let me give you a couple of the elements of what is going on and why China right now is the fastest developing country, or the country which develops the fastest. And you will get a sense that while we are looking on the one side of the, to the collapse of the financial system, rising unemployment in Europe, collapse of economies, that there is a completely different process where economic development is taking place, actually representing hope for mankind as a whole. Now, China is presently involved in absolutely gigantic infrastructure projects. Among them, they want to have a railroad net till the year 2000 increased by 11,000 kilometers. Till 2000, 90,000 kilometers altogether, which is twice the amount of today. They want to have completed the first 300 kilometers of a high-speed train between Beijing and Shanghai, also ready till 2000. They want to increase the road net roads by 12,000 kilometers. They want to build 14 large cities, 14 large subway systems. In the next 5 to 10 years, 100 airports, 100 ports. In the next 20 to 30 years, 200 cities with 1 million inhabitants each or more, because they expect a population increase of 200 million people and they want to supply adequate housing. Gigantic hydroelectric plants, large-scale canal and irrigation projects to divert the water from the water-rich south to the dry north. 4 nuclear power units come online in the next years, and many more are planned. And the first HTR, high-temperature reactor, is under construction. There are so-called projects of the century. One is the famous Three Gorges Dam project. Here you see an artist's painting, how it could look like when it's finished, which mainly has at its aim the taming of the Yangtze River, using also the water gained then in the reservoir for energy and irrigation. Next. And the second project of the century is the new Eurasian rail development, linking the Chinese coastal area through the enormous interior regions to Europe. Back to the previous one. Now, there is a whole array of ambitious projects on combining this Yangtze River development project along the entire Yangtze River. They also have projects for the Pearl River Delta in the southeast, the region along the Bohai Bay in the northeast, including the Beijing and Tianjin region, and then force the development corridor along the European Eurasian lane, rail line and the modern Silk Road. But of all of these projects, the most spectacular is the Three Gorges Dam on the Yangtze River. The construction of this began in 1994, going back to the idea of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. And this is a typical example for the hypocrisy of the environmentalists and the World Bank, for that matter, in the West, who have denounced this project tremendously to hurt the environment and so forth. But no, let's not forget that only in the last flood disaster, 33 million hectares farmland were flooded. 1,000 people died, 800,000 houses were destroyed, 2.8 million homes were damaged. And that is already after the Chinese government took some measures to limit the damage, because in previous centuries you had many flood catastrophes in which 10 or even 100 thousands of people would die. Now this dam is supposed to be completed in the year 2010, and then the danger of these floods will be eliminated. It will also produce hydroelectric power of 85 terawatt hours per year, but most importantly, it will eliminate the threat to 15 million people living in this area. It will cost $30 billion, but in the long term, it will be incredibly profitable. The hydroelectric power plant with a maximum capacity of 17,680 megawatt will produce 13 times the amount a normal nuclear power plant produces. It will be the most powerful hydroelectric plant in the world, and it will be a key element in China's nuclear in China's energy grid, at least until nuclear energy is developed. Part of it will be a five-level system of locks, which can lift 10,000 GRT, cross-registered tons, which will enable ships to travel upstream until the city of Chongqing, which will make 700 kilometers of the Yangtze navigable. Then you will have in China a river like the Rhine in Europe, and all of you who have ever been in Germany or Holland have seen what a beautiful thing this Rhine is, which is completely regulated. You have one ship like, one after the other, freighters going. Every time Lin sees that, he says, this is infrastructure, that's how it should look like. So China is going to have their own Rhine very soon. Through the dam, a volume of freight will be increased from presently 10 to 50 million tons, and the cost will be reduced by one third. Naturally, it will also be a gigantic reservoir. Through a canal which is yet to be built, the water will be transported to the north next for irrigation. This will open up a territory larger than Germany for infrastructural development and agriculture in the north. In September of last year, there was an agreement between the USTVA, the Tennessee Valley Authority, and the Chinese government in the collaboration to build these dams and power plants and canal systems, basically taming the River Han, which flows into the Yangtze, through this canal system into the north, and also the River Li, to also contain flooding there. The project to divert water from the Yangtze to the Yellow River through this modernization of an existing canal makes use of the fact that at the beginning of both rivers, they are not very far from each other. So you can put the water of the Yangtze through a canal system feeding the irrigation system of the north of China. And basically what this will then mean is that the desert of Gobi will be a blooming garden fairly soon. Till the year 2000, it is also planned to then make an increase and modernize and continue the development project at the mouth of the Yangtze near Shanghai. Next, this will be a $100 billion investment program, planning a new port, a modern communication from Shanghai to Chongqing, a new airport, oil refineries, two auto plants, a nuclear plant, increase the steel production to above 48 million tons, which by then will be half of the Chinese steel production, improve the road and railway from Shanghai to the cities at the upper Yangtze, to build alone four new railroads and eight new highway bridges over the Yangtze, and the 1,330 kilometer high-speed railway between Beijing and Shanghai. The region of the delta of the Zhujiang River and the Guangdong Canton is also one of these development zones. Everything right now is prepared for the economic integration of Hong Kong. Next. One, probably the largest development project in the world right now, next, is the famous Bohai project. This is the region at the mouth of the Yellow River in the northeast of China, and it includes four regions of Shandong, Shaanxi, Hebei, and Liaoning. It includes Beijing and the port of Tianjin, parts of Inner Mongolia, and as I said, it will be probably the richest development region of the world in a fairly short period of time. Already now, that is the centerpiece of Chinese industrial concentration. It represents only 12% of the territory, but 20% of the Chinese population is living there, and they produce one quarter of all production. It is an economic zone which also puts together China, Japan, North Korea, South Korea, and the far east of Russia. Already now, the Bohai region is the center of Chinese heavy industry machine tool. It represents the second largest oil and gas revenues of China, the third largest chemical production, and a gigantic economic potential, basically being in the backyard of Beijing. In the next years, seven large new ports are planned or supposed to be enlarged to also connect this region better to the highlands. Many roads and rails are planned. Key of the new development, and there you see the circle, is a bridge over the Bohai Bay, which basically connects the two peninsulas of Shandong and Liaoning. This will be the largest sea bridge in the world, 57 kilometers long, which will shorten the distance along the coastlines by 2,000 kilometers. It will be an ideal connection between the Northern Eurasian land bridge, the line A on the previous picture, and line C, combining practically these two different routes. It will also include several bridges, one tunnel. It will be completed by the year 2010. Until then, a modern railroad ferry is used between Dalian, the main port of Liaoning, and Yantai in Shandong. In this entire region, the Bohai region, in the next 15 years, 3,600 infrastructure projects will be built, including road and railroad, heavy and light industry, nuclear plants, new cities, and so forth. So the idea behind that is nothing less than the idea to connect the developed coastal regions with the undeveloped interior regions and Europe, and to use the development of the coastal area as a development driver to overcome the underdevelopment of the interior regions. Now, in 92, as I said, the Eurasian land bridge already exists. In 1990, the 4,131 kilometer long railroad was completed at the Atalaf Pass between China and Kazakhstan, which was opened in 92 for container transport. Now, the last part of the 11,000 long line going from China through Turkmenistan to Europe was opened in May 96, the famous peace between Iran and Turkmenistan. Now, the construction of turning these infrastructure lines into industrial corridors, and I come to explaining what that means in a second, is already Chinese policy. It's part of the present five-year plan and the strategic long-term planning. Now, it includes the port of Lianyungyang, I forgive my Chinese here, which will connect, which is located between Shanghai and Tsingtao, and which represents right now the, one could say, natural end of the Eurasian land bridge. Other ports will be built there, for example, Rizhao, Tsingtao will be modernized, as well as Tianjin, Shanghai, Shenzhen, and Guangzhou in Canton. now, the idea is basically to integrate this existing rail line with an electricity grid, oil and gas pipelines, the installation of an optical fiber net, next, which already will start to operate in April of this year, in 3 months from, 2 months from now. This will be 27 kilometers long, and it will be the longest in the world, connecting Frankfurt in Germany to Shanghai, supplying 20 countries on the way. The idea is also to have industrial projects along this line to process the rich natural resources along the Eurasian land bridge, for example, petrochemical complexes and so forth. For the next 20 to 30 years, the Chinese government has planned, as I said, along this line mainly the construction of 200 new cities, which is a gigantic project. Next. Now, a very interesting strategic development project is also, no, next, Tumen, the Tumen Economic Zone. This is a region representing an area of 10,000 kilometers at the mouth of the Tumen River, including the border region between Russia, China, North Korea, and Vladivostok, which is the end of the Trans-Siberian Railroad, and is a triangular between Vladivostok, Yangtze in China, and Chongqing in North Korea. The key is a rail connection from Nanjing in North Korea to Posyet in Russia over Chinese territory to the city of Chita, which will shorten the distance to Europe by 1,700 kilometers. A connection is also planned basically to South Korea, and this is supposed to be a 30 billion investment program for the next 20 years, and basically be a power zone of a system of ports and industrial production comparable to Rotterdam in Holland. So it will be a gigantic port, trade, and industrial complex, and obviously for the purpose of peaceful collaboration of the countries involved will be absolutely crucial. Okay, now I want to look at some of the other pieces of the Eurasian land bridge, namely the southern corridors. Next. the revival of the Silk Old Silk Road as a concept was mainly pushed on the impulse of China and Iran. But now it involves the very active participation of Turkey, the Central Asian republics, Russia, Pakistan, and India. And obviously, the whole concept of what this region is all about, being, you know, changing from an area of continuous instability, geopolitical manipulation, and so forth, is now moving into a region of economic cooperation to the mutual benefit of each involved. Now, on the 13th of May, in Tehran, there was the opening of the 300-kilometer rail line from Mashhad to Sarax and Tejin, with the participation of 12 heads of state, 50 nations, and 1,500 delegates. This is concluded the missing link of the transcontinental rail between China, Turkey, and therefore Europe on the southern route. And President Rafsanjani of Iran at that point praised the revival of the historic Silk Route as a symbol of East-West relations, the bridge for the region and the world. Li Peng, who was also present, spoke of the Silk Road for the 21st century and basically represented there the extremely close collaboration between China and Iran. In the meantime, a flood of bilateral and multilateral agreements for the region has been concluded. in August last year, Erbakan went with 102 Turkish businessmen, concluding a new era in the Turkish-Iranian relations, a 20 billion natural gas deal, a new pipeline, new rail lines, the integration of the energy grid. And basically fostering many of these projects in the region. Now, one of the reasons why Turkey, despite all economic problems, has basically had a relatively interesting economic development in the recent period was because of the Southeast Anatolia project, which is an area of 75,000 kilometers, which includes 22 dams, 19 hydroelectric plants for electricity and irrigation of an area of 1.7 million hectares. This is supposed to increase the national income of Turkey by 12%, and it should be noted that all of this was done without international financing and without international help, all by Turkish engineers. China, in the meantime, in the summer of 96, gave a 270 million credit to Iran to help to build the Tehran subway with Chinese participation and put many more projects on the table to which basically the foreign minister of Iran, Velayati, gave the policy direction of the government by saying one cannot be a peaceful country in the middle of a region of instability and one cannot be a rich country in a region full of poverty. So I think that it is extremely important for the United States to reconsider their policy towards Iran. I mean, first of all, there has been a very important shift in Iran, which I can only compare to the change which has occurred in China. China has very consciously turned away from the Cultural Revolution and, you know, decided to go in the opposite direction. Maximum technological progress, maximum development of the interior of the regions. And in a similar way, Iran has had its own experience with the revolution, with the war with Iraq. And they, like China, are thinking, how can they accommodate their people, their growing population, which will be 100 million people by the year 2000, you know, with appropriate living conditions. Now, there are massive giant projects for the common exploitation of the enormous oil and gas resources at the Caspian Sea. And obviously, there are many projects in which Iran participates, for example, in Azerbaijan, in the Shah-Deniz Consortium. The idea is to have Iran natural gas to Nakhchivan and Armenia and Georgia and Ukraine. There's also an oil swap between Kazakhstan to save transport costs. Kazakhstan will export oil to northern Iran, and then Iran will sell oil to be exported to the benefit of Kazakhstan. There will be a pipeline between Iran and Pakistan, part of the Eurasian pipeline net, and oil from the Caspian Sea and the Gulf will then be possible to directly ship to Europe, Russia, Ukraine, but also Pakistan, India, China, and Southeast Asia. So you are also looking at a Eurasian energy bridge. Now the Caspian Sea oil and gas resources are obviously the center of a lot of international attention these days. But next, it should be noted that Iran wants to change the dependency on these resources to favor its own industrial development in depth. Some of these passes so that you get an idea. Based on science and technology, to increase the productivity of its labor force, so there is an important change going on in which Iran consciously wants to define its role as being the gate between East and West and North and South. There are massive state investments going on, 8 major dams built between 89 and 94. 25 new dams are in construction and 70 are in a planning state. The first plans for the use of water power developments, by the way, for Iran, were sought out in the United States in the 50s by the US Tennessee Valley Authority and represented part of the Franklin D. Roosevelt plan to develop the post-war world. So people should remember that there was a time in which the United States had quite a different policy towards Iran, not least in the Shah period. Iran is also doing major investments in its own fertilizer industry. It wants to double its electricity production from 89 to 95 and has massive investments in the metal industry, machine tool, shipbuilding, aerospace and steel, refineries and petrochemical industries, which they want to double in the next 5 years to bypass Saudi Arabia. Next, for the Central Asian republics, the Silk Route is the only hope for the future. This concerns Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan, which are in the very interesting geographical position between China, Russia, India, and Europe. And this is an area twice the size of Europe. Most people don't know this, but this is a region with a very rich cultural tradition. It's too long now to go into that, but you know, one of the greatest thinkers of mankind, Ibn Sina, was born in Bukhara, which today is Uzbekistan, just to mention one. This region has an enormous wealth of raw materials, but they are relatively poor. I mean, now go back to this mountain picture. the reason was that during the time of the Soviet Union, there was a relatively one-sided development. A cotton monoculture in Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and Tajikistan. The Soviet Union got 90% of their cotton from there. And obviously, for this, they used an enormous amount of water for irrigation out of the rivers who flood into the Aral Sea. As a consequence of that, the water level of the Aral Sea has sunk dramatically. The sea has shrunk by half, and there is now a big danger of an ecological disaster. Sandstorms and enormous amounts of salt flying around. There is also the danger that the lake may disappear completely. Already during the time of the Soviet Union was the plan to direct the water from West Siberia to the Aral Lake through a canal, which would then be used basically for irrigation in this entire region. This would require big pumping stations where the water would be pumped over the division between West Siberia and the Aral Sea basin. And from there, the water would flow by gravity all the way to the southern end of the canal and feed basically a large reservoir. This canal can be built in 15 years, back to the previous one. It would cost $18 billion. Gorbachev was, by the way, the one who abandoned that project. And right now, this region is gripped by a rather severe economic crisis. All kinds of multinationals are stepping on each other's toes for a raw material grab. There's the danger that there's a repetition of the old British great game in the region. And it is very clear that only a crash program of infrastructure development of the European Eurasian land bridge makes it possible to solve the problems of this region. Now, the main rail line of the Eurasian land bridge goes from China to Kazakhstan over the Alatov Pass between Aktogai and the Kazakh border town of Druzhbar, then along the main corridor of through Almaty, the former Alma-Ata, Chambul to Tashkent, at which point it divides. One route goes to the northwest to Arabak and Orenburg, Kujibesh, Kubichev, Moscow and Europe. And the second route divides in there in Tashkent to Samarkand, Bukhara, Tejen, Meshed, Iran, Turkey and Europe. And it is this second route, this southern route, which is actually the old Silk Route. Now, these lines are planned and in part completed, but obviously they must be fully built up to become infrastructure development corridors. The richness of the raw materials in this region are an advantage, but they must be used to overcome the dependency of these raw materials. And therefore, these corridors must be fully developed, not just as transport lines, but as functioning agricultural and industrial production complexes, which is not impossible because, for example, in Kazakhstan, you have the advantage of a very qualified labor force from the old military industrial complex of the Soviet Union. Next. Le Figaro on the yesterday, actually, had the following article: Caucasian participation in Eurasian land bridge. Countries of the Caucasus decided to reopen old Silk Road. And basically quoting people from the region that after the collapse of the Soviet Union, they intend to exploit their geographical position. As one representative put it, God has given us a strategic position, being the north in the north-south axis between Scandinavia and Turkey and an east-west axis between China and Europe. Next. Iran is also building full speed the connection between Kerman and Zahedon to the Pakistan rail net to the border town of Minchaveh. This will mean that for the first time there is a continuous rail corridor between Europe and Bangladesh, and it is the last step of the rail connection from India to Bangladesh to China to Southeast Asia. Now, China recently built an important railway bridge from the from Huili, a town in China, to Mao Shweli in Myanmar, and from there it's supposed to build a 250-kilometer railway to the northwest to connect to the Rangoon Mitkinya line, Mishnah line. So this will also then be the connection to Nanning in South China. It will include the greater Mekong subregion. It will connect China, Burma, Myanmar, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam. In the further development is planned a high-speed railway from Kuala Lumpur to Singapore, the upper circle, and eventually a rail down all the way to Jakarta, at which point you will have a one railway from Rotterdam to Jakarta, and you can travel by train from Holland to Indonesia in the very near future. I find this absolutely exciting because I do not like airplanes. So let me give you very briefly a couple of the theoretical aspects which are absolutely critical to make this project function. Because the new Silk Road has, without any question, to lead not only to a recovery of the world economy, but to the greatest economic miracle in history throughout the entire Eurasian continent, but also reaching all parts of the world. What is absolutely key, therefore, is the concept of the development corridors, which is supposed to bring the development in those less developed areas. And the location of these corridors depends first on geographic considerations, but also on principles of physical economy, of which Mr. LaRouche is the most advanced spokesman and theoretician today. but let me first go to the geographical aspects. The famous old Silk Road, which was linking ancient civilizations of India, China, the Middle and Near East, Europe and Africa, basically was trade routes connected through cities. And these trade routes spread knowledge and culture. And it is very interesting that the present distribution of the population along these old Silk Road lines, which is big rivers, coastlines, channels, roads, and railroads, that even if thousands, to be precise, about 2,200 years have passed, still 25% of the population of Eurasia and 70% of its urban population is living along only three transport corridors, of which each is about 100 years wide. Now you have a very heavy population density along these corridors. Now, the development of the railroads is key for the development of Eurasia because it is possible for the first time to open up the vast hinterlands of Eurasia. Mr. LaRouche referenced already that in 1869 in the United States there was the first transcontinental railroad in the world, and at that point people had the idea of an intercontinental railway net including Africa, Europe and Asia. But you know, we all know that the British Empire was completely determined to prevent this from happening and regarded it as casus belli. This was one of the key reasons for World War I and World War II and decades of the Cold War. As a result of this interruption in completing what seems to be so natural in the interest of mankind, after 100 years, namely 100 years after the first transcontinental rail line in the United States, there is only one continuous rail line in Eurasia. There was only one continuous railway in Eurasia until last year, which was the Paris-Vladivostok Trans-Siberian Rail Line. And now there are three major rail connections: the northern, the middle, and the southern route. And it is very clear that these transport lines, one has to look at as transporting many more goods in the near future because of the population growth than what is happening now. So we are only looking at the beginning of a gigantic development. Several nations participating in this are right now modernizing the existing lines or building new lines and are engaged in the modernization of the track transfer at several of the borders because the tracks are different sizes. Now, there are massive plans in India right now, massive plans to improve the northern routes via the island of Sakhalin to Japan. Next, there is a plan to build a tunnel under the Bering Strait to the United States. Next. So if you look at the map of the population concentration in the world, one can see that the only areas which have a comparable population density to the productive triangle in Europe is first in China, in the river valleys along the Yellow River and the Yangtze, parts of Korea, parts of Japan, Java in Indonesia, parts of India and Bangladesh, and the northwest coast in the United States and the area of the Great Lakes in the Midwest. Now, the reason why this is important from the standpoint of physical economy is because low population, contrary to the idiots of the environmentalist movement and criminals like Lester Brown, low population density is actually a negative economic factor. Because what you have to look at is the cost per capita for the specific living standard and level of production, which is, and a large factor in that is the basic infrastructure cost. Now, basic infrastructure cost involves roads, railroads, public transport, production and distribution of energy, supply of usable water, canalization, communication, healthcare, and education. Now, if you think about that, it is clear that the average cost, for example, for 1 million people in a well-planned city is much less than for 1 million people who are spread thinly in rural areas. Therefore, cities are representing a much higher efficiency because, first of all, you have much lesser distance to conquer for persons, goods, and services to be supplied. You have a higher intensity of use of all the systems, for example, transport, education, and so forth. And thirdly, you have a better use of the technologies in urban centers. You have a higher energy flux density and a higher power density of machines. Therefore, you can do more useful work with a relative smaller expenditure of labor materials and land area per unit output. This parameter, by the way, the energy flux density, coheres directly with the increase of population density. In other words, the more people you have, the higher must be next the density of the production process. Therefore, advances in technology always lead to and can lead to an increase in the population, potential population density. Conversely, an increased concentration in population density stimulates the progress of technology. This is not only true for cities, but also for populations along rivers, trade routes, and so forth. If you compare the relative energy efficiency of the United States, France, Japan, in the time before the crisis erupted, let's say 1980, they had a roughly comparable standard of living, health service, and industrial activity. But Japan required the least expenditure of energy per capita, but they had the highest density of energy use per square kilometer. So there is very clearly an advantage of greater density. Next. The typical infrastructure corridor along these transport lines should be imagined in the following way. You have a corridor of approximately 100 kilometer wide, which includes a rail line, a high capacity electric power line, oil and gas pipelines, water supply lines, fiber optics, communication lines, and so forth. The most essential precondition for any industrial and agricultural and urban construction are these infrastructural arteries, which once built, you can then branch out and eventually cover the entire territory, but starting the development from these arteries and then branching out into the lesser developed areas. Along these arteries, you also want to have new cities, which in parentheses must be built beautifully, not like Houston. There are very many beautiful architecture models in the ancient cultures of Eurasia, and you know, people should use the fact that nowadays it's so much cheaper to build, to not neglect beauty. I mean, just think about the beautiful cities of China, of Korea, of Thailand, and other places, and there are many ideas how these places can be built beautifully. Now, the infrastructure corridor model is important because if you only build a rail line to connect, let's say, A to B over a long distance, then that railway is only a cost factor. But if you have this kind of an approach, then through the dense agricultural and industrial activity, the line from A to B becomes an economic multiplier, and the larger the density of the economic activity along the route is, the more efficient the investment into the initial railway becomes. So what you want to create is both large markets and large suppliers of goods, so that the connection from A to B has the role of a gigantic production line. Now, this approach is obviously the unique way to overcome the disadvantages of unfavorable natural conditions, let's say, of Arctic Siberia, deserts of Central Asia, and landlocked areas in principle. And it is also clear that, therefore, the continuous development of a corridor is more advantageous than, let's say, islands of economic activities which have no immediate connection. Now, let me go very briefly into some of the absolute necessary technologies needed to make the Eurasian land bridge succeed. The need exists to use avant-garde technologies in these corridors. Once you use them in the corridors, they will be distributed to the participating nations of the land bridge. In this way, the corridors become the transmission belts for scientific and technological progress in all of Eurasia. If the Eurasian land bridge is supposed to become the locomotive for the world economy, it is important to apply the principle of physical economy in selecting the most important technologies for transport, energy, water, and communication. Now, since the average parameters of performance of infrastructure in the Eurasian corridor must supersede those in Japan before the crisis in all categories for electricity, heating, fuel per capita and square kilometer, supply of households, industrial production, agricultural production, water, and so forth, the performance of transport systems in ton kilometers and value ton kilometers per hour per capita and square kilometer, communication systems and health and education systems. Therefore, the selection of technologies must be based on the relative highest density of performance in terms of the infrastructure performance per unit of land area, per employed worker, and per other resources consumed by the given infrastructural system. The higher performance correlates broadly with the energy flux density or power density of that technology, as measured in watts per centimeter of power flow through the crucial work surface of the process involved. The technological quality of the energy system, therefore, must increase. For example, there must be a growing role of the electricity versus thermal power, of high temperature heat versus low temperature heat, increasing the speed in passenger transport, and so forth. The infrastructure projects also must be designed in advance to anticipate the introduction of more advanced technologies when the corridors developed. The integration of all means of transport, water transport, railroad, planes, and trucks must be also included, including the containerization of freight transfer from one mode to the other. Since there is a dramatic increase in global demand for multi-mode transport projected, it is key to already now anticipate the overcoming of the bottlenecks. There are already existing engineer designs for fully automated freight transfer stations, so-called combi terminals. In France, the first generation of rapid transfer systems is already in operation, the so-called commuter facility in Trappes near Paris. The present conventional system, state of the art, is the use of portal cranes, which run along 700 meter long trucks parallel to the train tracks, then to unload a typical container train of 600 meter length carrying 40 containers. Such a crane normally requires at least 70 minutes. With the first generation of automated rapid transfer systems, this can be reduced to 15 minutes or less. For example, in Germany, Krupp is presently developing such a system called the Fast Freight Transfer Facility. The Eurasian land bridge must combine all major modes of transport. But the reason why the railroad transport must play a central role is because it requires much less energy and less labor. It is also less affected by climate and weather than road or ship. Existing systems are obviously the French TGV with 300 kilometers per hour and 150 kilometers or more for new high-speed freight lines. Also, the present Eurasian land bridge is based on conventional railroad technology. Next, it is absolutely crucial that the magnetically elevated ground transport plays a decisive role in the future. One existing model is the German Transrapid, which can go 450 to 500 kilometers per hour and hopefully will be built by the year 2005 between Hamburg and Frankfurt, Hamburg and Berlin, if present resistance can be overcome, and then eventually extend to a Europe-wide network. With this Transrapid, you can go from Paris to Beijing in 6 or 7 hours. So you can easily go in the morning and leisurely do your work on your terminal, have telephone work, and you know, by the afternoon you are in Beijing, well rested, securely, without weather storms in the air and so forth. So Japan is only slightly behind Germany, building a different system, and also China is working on one. There's a very interesting model presently by some Ukrainian scientists being worked on. Now, obviously, this kind of travel is revolutionary. It eliminates vibration and friction because it's not connected to the ground, and the speed is really nice to get ahead. Now, this technology will be very efficient in all of Eurasia. It will replace short and middle distance flights because it's completely ridiculous. If you go from New York to Washington, you spend 2 hours to get to the airport, 1 hour in the air, 2 hours to get from the airport. With this, you will have 1 hour travel and be where you want to be. Now, the total investment for the maglev system of the type of the Transrapid of a total length of 100,000 kilometers will be approximately $1 trillion. That sounds like a lot, but it's only $220 per capita of the Eurasian population in a span of 10 to 15 years. And for about 10 years, it requires an investment of only 1% of the GNP of the respective countries. But think about the change this will mean. Now, obviously, for the transport by sea, which is still the most efficient for bulk goods, and goods which are not dependent on time delivery, namely raw materials, semi-finished products, fuels, grains, heavy machinery, and so forth, this will also expand many times. Therefore, we will need a massive expansion of harbor facilities and major improvements of inland waterways, new inland shipping canals, and you know, many breakthroughs have been made in the recent period, for example, in the high-speed gas turbine-powered catamarans, which are used right now between Sweden and Denmark, which have about twice the speed of normal ferries. So this can be used all over the world, especially Indonesia is a place where the natural water roads offer themselves for this technology. Now, contrary again to what the environmentalist movement says, the world economy will be much more energy intensive in the future. You will have an enormous energy requirement for the economic exploitation, for example, of mineral resources, where technologies such as plasma processing will be used. Next. And we need a lot of water for the large scale desert regions in the near and the Middle East, in North Africa, Central Asia, and China, for pumping, reprocessing, and desalinization of water. Now, this will provide large amounts, we have to provide large amounts of cheap electricity, of which electricity today is the highest quality of energy, because we can easily distribute it on a large scale. And we also require large amounts of industrial process heat for buildings, industry, fuels for internal combustion engines, and so forth. Despite the enormous fossil fuels in Eurasia, the technology which has the highest energy flux density is, in the next future, nuclear fission, and hopefully very soon, nuclear fusion. There are right now extensive nuclear power programs in Japan, South Korea and North Korea, China, Vietnam, Indonesia, Iran, Turkey, and India. Presently, the light water reactor of approximately 1,000 megawatt is in use in many countries. France, for example, gets 80% of its national electricity from this reactor type. But what we propose is actually a much more attractive model. Next, the high temperature reactor developed by Professor Schulten from the Jülich laboratorium in Germany. This is the only existing HTR in construction right now near Beijing, which we visited May of last year. A similar reactor is being developed in the United States and Japan. But in any case, the HTR is much more efficient than the light water reactor because it also, among other things, produces process heat for industrial and other uses. The HTR is inherently safe because the possibility of a meltdown or other releases of radioactivities is ruled out by physical mechanisms. So without complex safety systems or human intervention, this reactor is safe, mainly because the encapsulation of the nuclear fuel within multiple layers of a special high-temperature ceramics, the so-called Siamant, which prevents the release of radioactivity even under extreme conditions. The HTR is therefore a robust and easy to operate reactor, safe especially in densely populated areas and as a component of the nuplex cities which have to be built. One big advantage of it is that it is based on the thorium cycle, of which India has large resources. As I said, presently China is the only country which builds HTR based on the Jülich type. Well, as I said, it is useful for many, many projects which I have mentioned. Okay, I could say many more things. I just wanted to give you a glimpse of, you know, on the one side, the gigantic construction activity, the physical principles this effort has to have. We have produced this study, so I invite you to study this in depth. Let me just go into two last aspects to give you an idea. Now, you realize probably that I did not mention Russia. And obviously, Russia is a crucial centerpiece within the Eurasian land bridge. And I can assure you, without doing what Leibniz said 300 years ago, of taking Europe and China and taking Russia as a mediation between these two cultures and bringing the development from both sides, there is no way how we will avoid a terrible catastrophe in Russia. Right now, as a result of the reform policy, the industrial production of Russia has collapsed to 20% average in the last 5 years of what it was in 91. General Lebed and others have warned that we are looking at a danger this coming spring because of a serious supply crisis. Now, fortunately, there is right now, even this is not represented by Yeltsin, Chernomyrdin as such, there is right now a growing group of scientists and other people in Russia who are absolutely fascinated, who want to integrate Russia into this Eurasian land bridge. Mr. LaRouche gave a seminar in April last year, organized by famous economists like Leonid Abalkin, with the participation of former Prime Minister Pavlov and 40 famous Russian economists, about this perspective. The proceedings in Russia, in Russian, were just published and are circulating widely in government and other circles, as well as a document which Mr. LaRouche wrote for the Russian Duma. When General Lebed was in Germany just 2 weeks ago, he very surprisingly and very positively announced the need for Russia to go back to the policies of Count Witte, which was exactly the same approach, and to use the German model of machine tool, Mittelstand, middle-level industry to transform Russia. Now, this obviously is very urgent, and no time is to be left. Let me just, as a last point, mention the German situation. Those of you who know Germany and love it like I do are probably crying right now of what is happening to this beautiful country. Rather than using the historical chance of 89 and, you know, transforming the East through technological means, Germany being really hoodwinked by the Anglo-Americans, by Thatcher, by Bush, by Mitterrand, is now collapsing. It is right now falling apart at a speed people cannot imagine. There are right now officially 4.5 million unemployed, but if you take the hidden unemployment, Germany right now has well above 8 million unemployed. That is higher than 1932 or 33, when Hitler came to power, and the situation is, even so there is no Hitler inside, the country is in a very, very dangerous situation. Germany has lost in the last 5 years 25% of its industrial employment. Now, this for Germany is a catastrophe, because the German economy, despite the present collapse, is unique. For example, in 95, the export of Germany was still 728 billion D-mark. 87% of that was industrial goods, mainly capital goods. 112 billion export in machine tool. 11 billion of those machine tool design. 126 billion vehicles, 96 billion chemical products, 96 billion electrical equipment, 13 billion precision and mechanical and optical goods, 15 billion aviation and space vehicles. Now, the only other country which has a similar situation is Japan. But they are more focused on the Far East, while Germany has a broader worldwide distribution. And there is no country in the world which is as dependent on the prosperity and stability of other regions in the world than Germany. Now, in Germany, we have seen since the unification a dramatic collapse of export-oriented jobs. 700,000 jobs alone in this area were lost. So the situation is absolutely dramatic. And if Germany is to be saved, it is so obvious. Germany has everything what all these corridors need. It is a crime to destroy these industries. The government right now, which is absolutely mad to fulfill Maastricht, a conception which was designed by Thatcher and Mitterrand to contain Germany, to weaken Germany, and to destroy it for geopolitical reasons, is right now in the process of turning Germany into a rubble field. Now, we are determined to put the Eurasian land bridge on the table as an alternative. Now, the reason why Germany has to play a crucial role is that Germany not only has this export dependency, but the reason for that was that Germany has a very large component of machine tool and Mittelstand. Now, this is extremely important for all the other economies as well, because contrary to what the monetarist school of Adam Smith and others are saying, the source of wealth of a country is not the resources. It's not oil, gas, strategic minerals, and all these other things. It's not speculation. It's not stocks. It's not the bubble economy. The only source of wealth in an economy is the creative reason of the individual. And if that creative reason is applied and leads to scientific and technological progress, which then is basically turned into machine tools, when you apply scientific and technological progress and make it usable for production, this occurs through the work of the engineer, the scientist. He turns it into a machine tool. And many of the machine tool Mittelstand industries in Germany were up to the present time run and headed by engineers who had a family firm with several dozen or several hundred employees, and they were the engine of technological progress. Now, Germany also obviously has a way of reversing its present course, because we do have a tradition of making people creative. Because Germany used to have the best education system in the world, the famous Humboldt education system, which was basically the reason why in the 19th century Germany was the leading country in the world in producing new technologies, in defining new categories of knowledge. And, you know, basically all we have to do is to go back to that education system, where the centerpiece is not specific skills, but the development of the character, the development of the character and beauty of the person, the development of the person to become a state citizen. So what we propose is basically to return to this and make Germany a centerpiece, and not let Germany collapse, but make it one of the leading motors in the driving of this Eurasian land bridge. We have what people need. Why should we collapse? We can help. Next. Now, there are two strategic areas where everybody can see that the regions will blow up if this is not done. One is the Balkans and Bosnia in particular, where the Eurasian land bridge must be a factor to calm down and develop the region. You all have heard that Bulgaria right now is falling apart. There is a terrible hunger catastrophe. The country is just collapsing. You have hyperinflation. complete standstill of the economy. Serbia is exploding, among other things, because of the economic condition. Albania, Kosovo. There will be another war for sure if Bosnia and the Balkans is not part of this very fast. Next. And I think that if you look at the continent of Africa, it is also clear that, you know, with what is going on in Zaire, Rwanda, Burundi, Sudan, the only way to stop the bloodshed, to stop the collapse, is to build the Eurasian land bridge as quickly into Africa as possible. This is the map of the railways which existed in 1990. Next. And what is proposed and what we propose is to connect the Eurasian land bridge fully to the African railway system as a totality. If this is being done with the help of China, other countries of Eurasia, Germany, Japan, and the full backing of the United States, there is no reason why Africa cannot be saved. It is eminently possible. Next. So what basically is required, therefore, and you know, this is the purpose of this seminar, is that the United States consciously goes back to the policies of FDR. Overcoming the depression through a dirigistic program, not only for the United States, but for the world as a whole. Next. If we do that, then each of us can look into the eyes of these children and many other children to come. If we don't do it, these children will not live.
First. This European-Eurasian land bridge is, no matter what the media says or not, the most important strategic question of today. And the success of the economic integration of the Eurasian continent on a very high-level technological basis will determine the fate of mankind. And this is not a question in the very far future ahead, but I think that considering the different strategic parameters, the question if the second Clinton administration takes a positive attitude to make it a foreign policy strategic interest of the United States to support the success of this Eurasian land bridge, or if they remain indifferent, passive, or worse, will indeed determine if mankind plunges into an incredible catastrophe of which the developments in Africa give us a small foretaste, or if we are in front of the biggest economic miracle in world history. This alternative is directly in front of us. And I think, next, if you the reason why this question is the most important is fairly obvious. If you look at the population density in the world today, you can see very clearly that the largest concentration of the world population is in China and Southeast Asia and South Asia, very thinly sprinkled in concentrations elsewhere. And this part of the world, South Asia, West Asia, Southeast Asia, is also going to be the area of the largest population growth in the next century. China presently represents 1.2 billion people. It is presently the most populous nation on the world, and it has, without any question, had the most intensive positive economic development of any country on this planet in the last 12 to 17 years, average 10, even 12% annual growth. Now, the fascinating thing right now is that at the Davos World Economic Forum, despite rather hysterical misreporting by the international press, the European Eurasian Land Bridge and the economic development of China, but in a new way also of India, is the most debated topic in Davos in the last couple of days. It is very funny that, you know, while for a long time Mr. LaRouche was like a sole caller in the desert, warning about the imminent collapse of the financial system, advocating the Eurasian land bridge, and the international media basically denying both realities, as a matter of fact, not reporting about the true condition of the world financial system, but equally absolutely not reporting about the emerging alternative reality in the form of the Eurasian land bridge. Now, all of a sudden, at the Davos summit, both realities are popping out and are on the table, because the two issues which were debated there by some of the world leading financial, economic, and political leaders was, on the one side, the imminent financial crash of the speculative bubble, possibly triggered by the crisis in Japan or other factors, the systemic crisis of the system as a whole, but also the Eurasian land bridge. And some people were completely annoyed about the self-assuredness with which the Chinese representative and...
$250,000 or more for the experience of having the house collapse around you. And that's our economy. As a result of this kind of economy, we have built up the greatest financial bubble in history. A bubble which amounts to trading of about $3 trillion a day, where the support is collapsing from underneath it. This bubble will collapse. Nothing can prevent this bubble from collapsing except putting it into bankruptcy. Therefore, there are three elements which are required to get out of this mess. First of all, a number of governments led by the United States executive, that means President Clinton in this period, whatever you think of Clinton, he's got the ball, must initiate an emergency new Bretton Woods conference to reestablish immediately the best features of the Bretton Woods system prior to 1966. That is, a system of stable parities, a system which whose trade and tariff agreements are essentially protectionist in nature, yeah? A system to foster cheap credit for long-term investment in international markets, and to foster scientific and technological progress. A new Bretton Woods, which must essentially meet over a weekend, declare the present international monetary and financial institutions to be bankrupt, to agree to put these institutions into government-supervised receivership for reorganization, to prevent social chaos, and to preserve essential structure of fiscal and financial administration, and to foster a cancel all existing trade and tariff agreements, to set up a new set of mutually advantageous protectionist arrangements in order to foster investment and growth within national sectors. Once that's done, the second thing is to find a major series of projects which can lead to an economic recovery in the sense that Roosevelt, during the late 1930s, conceived an economic recovery of the United States. You must have large-scale infrastructure projects, otherwise no economic recovery. And this world is a mess. Most of the world does not function precisely because there's not the infrastructure present in terms of transportation, power, and so forth to enable the world to function. You can't have peace in the Middle East because there's not enough water in the area of Palestine in adjoining Jordan to sustain the existing population. Without large-scale water development projects, which includes desalination on a mass scale, there's no possibility of peace in the Middle East, as typical of the infrastructure projects. The problems in Africa are largely the key economic problem is infrastructure. Clean water to drink, efficient transportation, adequate power resources. Without these elements, there is no hope of economic development in Africa. In Asia, we have the greatest concentration of the world's population, with a totally inadequate inland infrastructure development. The greatest part of the human population ready for growth, but unable to do so effectively for reason of lack of adequate development of infrastructure. So therefore, the Eurasian land bridge conception, an idea which was initially presented in the 1860s by Henry C. Carey, the economist who was also a partner of President Abraham Lincoln. And Carey proposed that the lessons of Europe and the United States in opening up the western lands from the Atlantic to the Pacific, and then similarly in Europe, through railroad development corridors be utilized throughout Eurasia from the Atlantic to the Pacific and to the Indian Ocean to accomplish similar results in Eurasia. This policy presented by Carey, which was later adopted by important circles in Germany, was spread into Russia, into China and others, and resulted in a policy which caused Britain to organize World War I. That is the so-called land bridge program of certain French interests associated with Sadi Carnot, the president of France who was assassinated, with Gabriel Anatol, the foreign minister and historian, with Count Sergei Witte of Russia, with circles around the, in which I announced the imminent disintegration of the Comecon and Warsaw Pact in their present form, and indicated not, both that Poland would probably be the first nation to break out of the Comecon Warsaw Pact alliance, and secondly, that Berlin would likely become soon the designated new capital of a unified Germany. I indicated that we must take, from the standpoint of the United States, that for the coming period of the coming administration, the primary policy question on the table of the United States would be the breakup of the Warsaw Pact Comecon alliance, and that the United States would have to base its global policy on that fact as the central feature of the strategic landscape for the coming period. Within a few months, I also broadcast this on the national television broadcast here in the United States, a televised copy of that address which I gave in Berlin at the Berlin Press Conference. Within about a year from there, as we all know, the Berlin Wall began to crumble. It had started, as I had indicated earlier, in Poland, which was the first nation to break the Comecon bonds. Then in October through December of 1989, the Berlin Wall crumbled. And there were two policies on the table of the world. One was the policy which I'd indicated, that we must reach out to the former Soviet Union and the states of Eastern Europe to create a new form of economic cooperation, based in part on the fact that in the Soviet military-industrial sector, there was one of the most important concentrations of strategic machine tool capability in the world. And the collaboration between the United States and France and Germany, especially Germany, with that sector would be the potential science technology driver for a generalized world recovery. That was my policy. It was also the policy of a leading German banker, Alfred Herrhausen of Deutsche Bank, who unfortunately was assassinated in British interest in November of that year on the basis of a similar policy which he had enunciated for Eastern Europe. The other policy was the policy of Margaret Thatcher and the person she describes as her little poodle dog, President George Bush, who she could make do anything she wanted to make him do. I asked Helga about that, how that works. Sometimes the dogs make you do what you want them to, they want you to do, but other way. So Bush and Thatcher took the wrong policy. We're now in a global disaster. The likelihood of civilization surviving in its present form to the end of the century is almost zero. We are presently in the worst financial crisis in the history of modern Europe. Within a matter of weeks or months, some say weeks, some say months, it doesn't make any difference. The Titanic is sinking anyway, and the day in which it sinks is not the issue. The The question is, do we have the sense to get off the ship before it sinks? Not can we, like the hogs on Wall Street, wait till the last moment to get out of the market just before it collapses? That's people get slaughtered doing that. So the two issues are this. First of all, to deal with this crisis and the banking system collapse is inevitable. It is not because Japan's bad policy or somebody else's bad policy, it's because of everybody's bad policy. The IMF's bad policy, London's bad policy, our bad policy. We've been destroying modern economy. We've lowered the productive powers of labor. Most parts of the third world, especially Africa and to some degree Central and South America, are suffering far more than they ever did 30 years ago. The condition of mankind in general on this planet is far worse than it was 30 years ago in physical parameters. Yes, there is a facade, one might say a Potemkin village facade of prosperity still around the planet. It's like one of these houses you get in Northern Virginia. It's all facade, but the inside is not worth having. And they, you can try. The policy which is contained in the outlined presented in the book is one of three elements of policy about which the future existence of civilization depends, including the continuation of civilization even as far distant as the end of this century. It is a policy which, in part, the land bridge element, has been adopted by China, which is now receiving cooperation from Iran, significant cooperation from Iran, for reasons which Helga will indicate, has recently received endorsement and offers of cooperation from the President of India in meetings, public meetings with Jiang Zemin of China. It has the expressed interest of Turkey by the present Prime Minister Erbakan in terms of cooperation with Iran. Recently, we've had the government of Armenia has emphasized its importance of its collaboration with Iran because of this kind of policy. It has the support in significant degree of the foreign ministry of Russia, Evgeny Primakov. And in the most recent period, since the French government has broken with the British government in a dramatic move over the issue of British Commonwealth genocide in Africa, that the French government has entered into new degrees of cooperation with Germany, both against British Commonwealth genocide in Africa and also in support of Germany's, France's, Russia's, and other countries' interest in cooperation with Iran, with India, with Asia and Russia in developing this type of orientation of economic cooperation across Eurasia, across continental Eurasia, and into Africa. Now, the background of this is how we got into this business. It started formally in 1982-83, when I was invited by representatives of the U.S. executive branch to set up a back-channel discussion with the Soviet government. And it was agreed that the subject of my discussion would include, among other things, a presentation of my design for a strategic ballistic missile defense to be mutually supported, hopefully, by both governments, the development of which would be utilized to provide new technologies for recovery of the world in general from the economic disaster which was already then in progress. During 1982, from February of 1983, I conducted negotiations through this back channel with the Soviet government. In February, the Soviet government turned down the policy recommendation I made, though they were still interested in economic discussions. But in March of the same year, 23rd, the President of the United States, Reagan, adopted and presented the policy which I'd been discussing with the Soviets and became known as the Strategic Defense Initiative. Now, in the process of those discussions, in February, my last meeting with the Soviet representative, I met the same gentleman recently in Russia, we had some reminiscence on these things. But in my last meeting, I warned him that if the President of the United States were to offer the kind of cooperation which I had outlined to him and his government, and that if the Soviet government refused that offer of Reagan's, then within about 5 years, the Soviet economy would collapse. Right? Now, 1988 came, 5 years later. In Berlin, on October 12th of 1988, as a part of my Democratic nomination campaign, presidential campaign at the time, I gave a Columbus Day press conference in Berlin. Chinese movement of Sun Yat-sen in China, with interest pre-1894 interests in Japan of the Meiji Restoration, were all agreed on the development of railroad development corridors, not just railroad tracks, railroad development corridors, such as we had used in the United States in developing the western lands of the United States through railway corridors. That must be done throughout Asia. And people associated with the Bates tradition in the United States, with Emil Rathenau and Siemens and others in Germany, the forces I indicated in France, these circles of Dmitry Mendeleev and of Vita in Russia, were united in developing a series of railroad corridors which would extend from the Atlantic, from coast of France to the Pacific, across to the islands and down railroad connections down into Japan itself. The same thing to be done toward the Indian Ocean. The British said plainly at that time that this proposal was a threat to the British Empire. The development of a continental communications network of this type would mean that continental power of the Eurasian landmass would dominate over the maritime power of the British Empire, and that the British Empire would not tolerate. And thus the British succeeded by a number of measures in organizing World War I to prevent that from occurring. Now it's back on the agenda. Again, the British are prepared to destabilize China, prepared to destabilize Iran, destroy it, and so forth and so on, to prevent this project from occurring. The third element, the land bridge, addition of the land bridge program, which is our great recovery program for this planet for the 21st century, is the return to the machine tool principle. The problem we have in Asia, now Japan has a very good machine tool sector, though it's not being helped by the current financial situation or trade situation. Korea has a decent machine tool sector. Taiwan has relatively a very good machine tool sector. The Philippines used to have a bit of a machine tool sector until they shut it down and packed it up and shipped it out back to the United States. Indonesia has a very limited machine tool sector, chiefly under the top-down organization of Professor Habibie. Other states in Southeast Asia either have no machine tool sector or virtually none. In India, there's a machine tool sector which is very inadequate relative to the population. China has a machine tool sector which is being fostered, but it's inadequate relative to the population. We have destroyed the strategic machine tool sector in the United States has been virtually destroyed. We have depended upon Germany and Japan for the key elements of our machine tool sector. Without a strategic machine tool sector, you cannot maintain the rate of progress in the productive powers of labor which are needed to sustain a global recovery program. Without the fostering of the machine tool sector, the strategic machine tool sector, the type we used to associate with military technology, without that, you cannot muster the intellectual force needed to increase the productive powers of labor sufficiently to meet the moral requirement which we have to humanity in the coming period. And though those three things are the foundations of a recovery policy, a survival policy for civilization, for the remainder of this century and the next century, and the land bridge program is at the center of it. Helga, who worked with me closely with others in 89 and 90 in developing this program around the so-called Productive Triangle program in Europe, has been through various phases of this. She's been involved in discussions with China at a high level, discussions with other countries or coordinating that. Michelle Liebisch and Arno have been similarly involved with that directly and indirectly. So Helga will present the vital elements of the land bridge program as such. And then in the question period, you can ask us, including we have Mr. Michel Liebig and Mr. Arno Hellenbroich also available to answer your questions. Thank you.
Okay.
First slide, please.